Discuss about a pediatric foot deformity by the name of congenital vertical talus. Now, before beginning the topic itself, we need to enumerate all the pediatric foot deformities. So, broadly, we have classified into cavus deformities, which are having high arched foot, and planus deformities, which are having flat foot. In cavus deformity, we have CTEV, cavovarus foot, equinovarus foot, and equinovalgus foot. While in planus deformity or flat foot deformities, we have tarsal collation, which is a rigid flat foot. We have congenital vertical talus, flexible flat foot, accessory navicular bone, and calcaneovalgus foot. So here in this video, we will discuss about a congenital vertical talus deformity. Now, we have various other names for this deformity by the name of rocker bottom foot, rigid pes planus foot, or congenital convex pes valgus foot. So mostly it is a bilateral deformity, and most common cause is still idiopathic in less than 5%, 50% of the cases. But in some cases, it has been linked to the neuromuscular disorders such as sacral agenesis, diastematomyelia, myelodysplasia, arthrogryposis. Plus, a trisomy is seen in chromosome 16, 15, and 18 in some cases of the congenital vertical talus deformity patients. Now, this is a normal foot, normal pediatric foot, and this is a foot seen in a CVT patient. So, we need to look at three things. We need to look at the navicular, we need to look at the talus and the calcaneal bone. So as we can see here in a deformed foot, the navicular is dorsally subluxed or it is a dislocated navicular. So it has gone dorsally. So there is a dorsal subluxation or dislocation of the navicular. Then we come to the talus. So there is equinus of the talus. The talus has gone into equinus deformity. Then third is the calcaneum. The calcaneum has two deformities, which are equinus and the valgus deformity. But the equinus deformity of calcaneum is not that marked as the equinus deformity of the talus. So we have three. We have the dorsal subluxation of the navicular, we have a equinus of the talus, and we have equinus and valgus of the calcaneum bone. So how does the foot look on external appearance? So starting with the skin. So skin is callosed on weight, because of weight bearing skin is callosed. There are callosity on the plantar surface. On the plantar surface there are callus formation. And while on the dorsal surface there is a contraction. There is a contraction at the dorsal surface and there are callus deformities at the plantar surface. Tendoacles, posteriorly, long toe extensors, anteriorly, peroniae, laterally, and talonavicular capsule, medially, posterior ankle capsule, they all are contracted. So the both the posterior elements and the anterior and the lateral elements, they are all contracted. The valleus anterior, which is found on the dorsal surface, it is shortened. While the things that are found on the plantar surface, peronii, tibialis posterior, they may sublux anteriorly. So adding on to the anterior deformity. Talking about the bony changes, so we have discussed the talus we see a vertical talus here, vertical talus, and the articular cartilage, which is present on normally on the talar head, it is seen on the dorsum of the talus bone. Calcaneum, we see a lateral translation or a valgus deformity of the calcaneum. So when does the patient present to us? So mostly the patient, they present to us in the first year of life, and this deformity, as we have discussed, is a bilateral deformity. So forefoot is in valgus and it is dorsiflexed. So talking about the forefoot, as we can see here, forefoot is a dorsiflexed, and here in this picture we can see it is a in a valgus deformity. It is laterally deviated. Talking about the hindfoot, so hindfoot we have discussed, there is equinus of the calcaneum and there is a valgus deformity of the calcaneum. Medial border, as we can see here, it is a convex border. And plantar border or the sole, it is again a convex shaped because of the prominence of the talar head. So talar head is in equinus deformity, so that has led to a convex shaped sole here. So this convexity, it persists on the weight bearing. This leads to the rigid flat foot deformity. Then on the dorsal surface, we can see here there is a presence of deep skin creases. So there is deep skin creases over the anterior aspect of the ankle, and a dimple might be seen on the anterior lateral aspect. The ankle plantar flexion, it is rigid and it is restricted because it is a bony cause, and we have discussed because of weight bearing there might be seen callus formation on the heel and the sole region. Now this was about the clinical picture. Now how to diagnose? Since it is a bony deformity, so we need to get the x-ray done to look into the bones. So we have the four views which are important. We have AP view, lateral view, maximum dorsiflexion and maximum plantar flexion. So these are the four views that need to be done. So this is a normal lateral view in a maximum dorsiflexion, normal lateral view in a maximum plantar flexion, and this is a deformed foot in maximum dorsiflexion and deformed foot in maximum plantar flexion. So this x-rays are supine for the infants, but for weight bearing children, for older children, they should be done in a weight bearing position. So after the x-ray has been done, we should know that what to look into the x-ray. So there are many angles, but there are three important angles that need to be looked. The two angles are on the lateral view. So one is the lateral talo first metatarsal angle. So this is the talus bone and this is the first metatarsal. So this angle is the lateral talo first metatarsal angle. The second is lateral talocalcaneal bone. So this is the talus bone and this is the calcaneal bone, and the angle between these two is the lateral talocalcaneal angle. And third angle is on the AP, which is again between the talus and the calcaneal bone. So we need to know the normal value of these angles and how they are changed in a congenital vertical talus patient. So talking about the deformed foot, so we know that calcaneum is in valgus. So because of the subtalar valgus, this AP talocalcaneal angle, it is increased. Talking about the two lateral angles, so talo first metatarsal angle, it is inverted. So as we can see here in the normal foot, it is almost straight line, but here we can see it is a inverted angle. So this angle has gone negative. Then third is the lateral talocalcaneal angle. So because of the equinus deformity of the talus and the calcaneal bone, this angle is increased in these patients. So here we can see the, on AP view, we can see the talus and the calcaneum bone, and we can measure the angle between them. So we have various many angles as we can see here, but we should know that there are three important angles, and we need to know the normal values of these angle and how they are changed in the congenital vertical talus. Now coming about to the treatment. Now we have diagnosed that the child is having congenital vertical talus. So how to approach the child? So we should aim for a plantigrade, pain-free and a normal appearing foot. So first line of management will be a conservative management. So we know that there is early manipulation. Here in this case, it is a reverse Ponseti manipulation because the deformity is opposite to that of the CTEV. So we know that this is a medial side, the forefoot is in valgus. The forefoot is also in dorsiflexion on lateral view. So what we need to do is we have to adduct the forefoot. We have to displace it medially. So how we can displace it medially? By applying pressure on the medial side. So we apply medial side pressure and we perform the adduction maneuver of the forefoot. And we have studied that forefoot is in dorsiflexion. So we will simultaneously apply a plantar flexion force. So this whole maneuver is opposite to that of the Ponseti maneuver which we apply for the CTEV. So that is the reason this is known as a reverse Ponseti technique. So here the pressure is applied on the medial part of the talus. In Ponseti, it is applied on the lateral part of talus. And the forefoot here is adducted and plantar flexion. Opposite to that, as we see in the CTEV patient. So once the conservative management has failed, so we need to shift on to the surgical. So what all options we have in the surgical? So we aim to lengthen the soft tissues. So we have discussed that all the soft tissue are contracted, whether they are on seen on the lateral side, medial side, posterior side, or anterior side, they are all contracted. So we should aim for lengthening of all the soft tissue. Plus, we know that it is a bony deformity, so we need to reduce the all the dislocated joint. So lengthening is first done on the lateral side, on the peroneae. Then we shift to the posterior lengthening, tendo-Achilles, and then finally anterior lengthening of the long toe extensor and tibialis anterior can be done. Simultaneously, the capsule can be released, calcaneum cuboid and subtalar joints. All these capsules are contracted and they can be released. So we have seen that talonavicular joint is dislocated. The navicular bone has displaced dorsally. So this joint is approached on the from the medial side after causing lengthening of all these soft tissue structures, and after causing the release of the capsule, this joint is reduced and it is fixed with K wires. So this is about the surgical principle of treatment of the congenital vertical talus. Now for a child which is younger than 2 years, so we should aim for the lengthening of the tendons and fixation procedures. But for a child which is over the 2 years, then we should aim for the extensive release of all the soft tissue structures with a tendon transfer procedure can be done. So we know that the all our posterior tendons, tibialis posterior and peroneae, they have subluxated anteriorly, leading to the dorsiflexion deformity. So we need to convert this dorsiflexion deformity into the plantar flexion deformity by the tendon transfer. So for children which are more than 2 years, the extensive release followed by tendon transfer is the preferred procedure. Now when this procedure has even failed, then we can go for the removal of the navicular bone with extensive release tendon transfer, or we can finally go for the arthrodesis, either subtalar arthrodesis or triple arthrodesis. It may be considered when everything has failed. So this was about an overview on the congenital vertical talus. So we should know that what all deformities are seen, how to approach, what to look on the X-ray, what all treatment options we have. Thank you.